Hello and welcome everybody to Throwback Thursday on the Legends of League podcast. Anthony Maroon is my name. Most people just call me Maroon. We are coming to you live from the studio, our studio at Four Pines Brew Pub in beautiful Manly. Now, the Legends of League tournament, you'd know all about that. We did that for a few years on the Central Coast and in Newcastle. And we got so much good feedback about the Legends of League tournament, bringing the old boys back together, finding out what they're up to now and playing a bit of footy. It will be back once we get through this COVID nonsense. In the meantime, we are doing the podcast. So hopefully in the end, we'll have both. We're talking old school today with Tooves and Mark Spudd Carroll. So let's do it on the Legends of League. Hello, everybody. Welcome once again. It is the Legends of League podcast. Anthony Maroon is my name. You know all about the Legends of League tournament, and it will be back soon as we get through this COVID period. I am joined in the studio, 280-plus games, first grade. He's a Manly legend. He's a legend of coaching at the famous club as well. Of course, it's Geoff Toovey. Hello, Tooves.
Maroon, good to be here.
Good to have you, mate. And joining us via Zoom from his brand-new gym in the middle of East Sydney, Mark Spudd Carroll. Hello, Spud.
Oh, good afternoon, gentlemen. Can't wait to hear what we're going to talk about.
How's things going at your new gym, mate? I mean, I see those blokes I work with at Triple M. It's, mate, what do you do anything with them? They come in, they're like they've been at a Tupperware party.
As you say, James Hooper does triceps the whole hour. That's all he does.
Yeah.
All different style of triceps. But no, we have a bit of banter. And that's good. We call it first grade. You're not included yet. I've seen you punching pads.
Yeah.
We'll get to you later on.
Mate, it's all about consistency, mate. I'm consistent. Now, you, Spud, you played 200-plus first-grade games across a couple of clubs, and you had a successful stint in the UK as well. And Tooves, you are so synonymous with the Manly club, and you coached them to a grand final. You've had a successful – you are Manly to the core. That would be fair to say.
Oh, it'd be fair to say. I grew up in the area, yeah.
And, Spud, when we do our sports lunches and all that, we concentrate a lot on your time at Manly. So before I get to those successful times of the 90s, what is it about Manly, this club, established in 1947? They've won 8 premierships. They're one of those clubs people love them or hate them, particularly in the old days we'd say we go for our side and whoever's playing Manly. Tooves, you start this. What is the Manly Rugby League Club about?
Well, it's about tribalism, and I think that's what makes all rugby league clubs great, particularly, I suppose, Manly got its reputation through the 70s when they managed to persuade some players to come across from other clubs.
Like Souths.
Win a couple of premierships along the way. It's a great area. I think people enjoy being part of the community here, and they love cheering their Eagles on.
Yeah, and Spud, for you, we're virtually the same age. So you grow up, you're watching, blokes like Bozo Fulton and Maxi Krilich and Ian Thompson and Terry Randall. So you, from the outside looking in, what was it like for you as a kid?
Well, as a kid, I'm a Parramatta junior, so I'm a Westie. So we have. Manly was never on my radar of even thinking about playing for most of Hayden, mate. I really did. I just think Parramatta was on my side, but then I ended up getting graded at Penrith. But the idea of going to Manly, it's crazy how many South guys have actually gone across from there. Ian Roberts was just before me. Myself, I went across. But the thing is, I went there to win, just the culture of winning. At South Sydney, unfortunately, the stock wasn't there. But I remember when I signed up for Manly, we signed up Terry Hill, and then we signed up Dave Gillespie, and I said, mate, I'm signing straight away, and we end up having 4 great years there.
And it's a very resilient club, Tooves, if you think about it. 70s, they made and won a couple of grand finals. Into the 80s too, that famous rivalry with Parramatta. Into the 90s when you blokes played in grand finals and won a grand final. So through that period, they're looked into as the Silvertails, and then just beyond that Super League period, it was the only period where maybe the coffers weren't as full and maybe Manly was struggling a little bit, and then private ownership came along?
Yeah, that whole Super League debacle really was the death knell for Manly for a little while, and we had to join up with the North Sydney Bears, one of our arch rivals, our neighbours, and... to the Northern Eagles. So it was a very hard, difficult period for the Manly club through those years. And finally, eventually, the Northern Eagles fell over and Manly got the licence back again and been successful, particularly under Des Hasler, through those years, three grand finals and one successful one there as well.
Yeah, how did you feel, Tooves, when you first put on that Northern Eagles jumper?
Yeah, it was different, but I mean, it was an exciting time too because being together with our neighbours, which we as said that had that rivalry with, it was a difficult process, I think, particularly for mainly the older stock that was at both clubs. But I think the players enjoyed it. There was a lack of culture because it's such a new club. So I think we see it in some of the other clubs that had joint ventures as well in the league still to this day. It's very hard to manufacture a history and that culture at any club. And when you were forming a club like the Northern Eagles, it was very hard to find what our purpose was or what our character was.
Yeah. Yeah, I've had this discussion a lot with the Triple M people. Like, these joint ventures have got all these other things to contend with, like where they play and who barracks for who on the board and what jumpers they wear when they play on a certain day. But cutting back to you now, Spud, you talk about you left the Bunnies, you went to Manly, and because I know you so well, you had that discussion with Bozo where you said to Bozo, mate, I don't care what I get paid, I just want to win a premiership. So you're there in 1996 and you do win a premiership. Mm. Over the Dragons. It's a great period for the Manly Warringah side. You play alongside blokes like Tooves and Beaver, who have been regulars on the Legends of League podcast. That's got to be the highlight of your career.
Yeah, it certainly was and is, Maroon. As a kid, you dream about playing first grade. I didn't get there as quick as I would, which I thought I would, but I got an opportunity to go to Manly. It took us a couple of years to get it going. We probably, the first year, 94, we got the semis. We weren't here, so we weren't out the back door. 95, we lost three games all year. We lost the bloody grand final. 96, we won. Then we lost to Newcastle. They talk about three-peats, mate. We should have been three-peats, seriously. But that's footy. The footy gods gave us our hand, and unfortunately, we didn't land it.
Tooves?
Spud's wrapped it up there. I mean,
yeah.
Look. It's they say you got to lose one to win one. What a load of rubbish, eh?
Yeah.
A load of rubbish. Yeah. Look. That's life. It makes you builds your character. I think we had a really successful side for a period there. When I say successful, you don't have to win grand finals to be successful. I'm being serious here. I mean, the amount of good sides I've played with, some good friendships and stuff, as long as you're competitive and you're a chance to win the game every week, I think that's what the fans want. And that's what we talk about in rugby league, and we talk about those rivals, which I mentioned before, like Manly and Norse. Manly was born out of Norse eventually, separated from their area. Mm. And that's what it's about. It's those rivalries, those traditions, but also success is measured in different ways. And as I said, you don't have to win a grand final. There's plenty of players that don't win a grand final, and you couldn't say they weren't successful or didn't play a successful team. So I think we just need to take a step back from there and say, yes, it was a successful period for Manly, but I enjoyed every minute of it, and it didn't matter if we won a grand final or we didn't.
Yeah.
I mean, of course it does for me. Like, I'm glad we did. But at the end of the day, I still think it was a successful side and one I really enjoyed playing with.
I think, Maroon, what Tooves has just touched on, there's some players, like I said, have never won a grand final. Look at Blocker and Benny Elias and Ciro. Like, they made a grand final, but unfortunately lost. It's great to say you've made one and won one, but it's just as Tooves said, it's about your mateship. Mm. I used to love going to train at Manly. I really did. Everything was full of life and we learnt something every day. But I'll tell you now, we actually looked out for each other. No one ever touched my little halfback ever.
Mm. And Tooves, some of the great characters. I mean, I'm old enough to have watched Bozo play. Mm. Bozo and Arco, Peter Peters. I mean, they're colourful characters, aren't they, of a great club?
Well, yeah. The big one probably we missed there is Terry Randall,
Eagle.
He used to, really put his body on the line. And fans love it. And the guy I just mentioned in another interview, Johnny Gibbs was my favourite too. Head back, running with a blonde hair, local boy. Alan Thompson, great players. Maxi Krillich, the warhorse at hooker. There's been thousands of great players at Manly.
Mm. But Spud, just to get off topic here a little bit, mate, I must say to you that I'm sitting here and I'm trying to not say this. I'm trying to not bring this up. But you go on Fox League, you're wearing a blazer and a handkerchief and a spotted tie, and you come on the Legends of League podcast and you look like you're sitting in Katingle Unit at Long Bay Jail.
Mate, I'm sitting here, I've got my Spud shirt on. I'm just at my gym. Mate, I'm sitting nice and quiet. Do you want me to walk around and show you around?
Yeah, give us a look around, mate. Give us a look around.
Oh, this is the old school gym. Look at this. This is the old Spud's gym that was hanging up.
Yeah.
You got that there? Spud's gym.
Do you actually...
That's where all the action starts in there. See that, Maroon? That's what they call a little boxing ring, 2x2 metre boxing ring. Mate. Unfortunately, I'm so worried about coming in and seeing me, but you know, one day you'll come through that front door.
Mate, I'll get you in that boxing ring.
The first word I'm going to use for a long time, when you come through that door, Maroon, your first session is free.
So I'm going to get the shit kicked out of me for free, you little beauty.
Spud, do you work out? Do you work out? Do you participate with other people? You look like you lost a bit of weight.
Oh, you're a funny man, too. I like when you sit on the little high chair there trying to have a go. I've looked after you for those 4 years. I've got 180 stitches in one eye because Beaver had to score all the tries. I had to do all the work through the middle of bloody Beaver.
Yeah.
Spud, listen, let's not talk about your money balls. Hey, don't move your money balls. Jesus.
But
that wasn't a bad thing. He's going to whinge about that one, Murray, because he got his nose pushed away across that way.
Yeah.
But which way is my nose going? But the thing is, I had a little bit of a passing game in me.
And a kicking game.
I wasn't allowed to kick at training. Ever.
Hey, what about, you know, when you've left, you grew up around Guildford Way and then you ended up playing for the Rabbitohs in 1990, Spud. And well, I remember seeing you when you first came. I was only sitting in the stand, obviously. But I remember seeing you training there. He arrives at training there with his mullet hairdo and he looks like he's from Guildford. The only thing he's missing, he doesn't have a packet of durries.
I've got to go on your mullet.
Yeah, it's a beauty.
It's coming back. Mm.
But he thought he was a tough cat, Tooves, didn't he? And you play with him. What about have you ever heard that famous story? Maybe you'll tell us that, you know, when he was over, where was he in Phuket and Monique was up on
What's that
story?
That's the best story. Come on, Spud. That's one of the best stories I've ever heard from anyone.
We arrived in Phuket. What happened was I missed out on the kangaroo tour in 94. It was filthy. I ended up going over to Phuket for a holiday and first day, I said, I'm going to go jet skiing. So I went out jet skiing, got caught out there for 3 hours. I ran out of fuel. But then Monique wanted to, she's not really an adventurous type, Monique, but she wanted to go up one of those bloody flying things, yeah, with the
paragliders. Paragliders.
This little guy on the back, I won't call it, he had this little bloke who'd do the wind. Anyway, I was watching her going off, got the camera, ding, took off. She went down the end of the beach. They do a dropping motion where it comes down and then they take off and it goes back in the air again. Anyway, when she's coming back, I've got the zoom on the camera. I said, mate, she doesn't look very happy. As she's landed, the whole sail went over the top of her. On the corner of my eye, I see this bloke running away, the guy who's supposed to be doing the air. I pull the thing back, and she's got blood coming from her mouth, the fingernails are all bent back. What's happened? They dragged her through the sand.
We shouldn't laugh.
Chairs like that. It could have broken, mate, seriously, it could have broken her neck. So I've chased this bloke. I was back then wearing the old footy shorts, running through water, knee deep. They hopped in this boat and they got a machete and they cut the rope. And next thing, what was coming, I was furious and all these bloody people are coming trying to calm me down. Mate, I was throwing them like kingpins, strung around. The killer for me was when I took Monique to the hospital, she started getting a bit of a shine. They all thought I belled her.
What a great trip.
Yeah. Eh? What a great trip. Mate, Phuket, outstanding.
Mate, was Manly the best club you ever played for? Because you did play for the Bunnies. You had two stints with the Bunnies.
I think the opportunity to go to South Sydney under George Pickens. I went there to play second row, week in, week out with one of my idols, that being Les Davidson. And then he said, I want to turn you into a front row. And I said, mate, let's go. George, let's go. And I've got to thank George for that. I played for Australia for South Sydney in 1990. Out of the blue, made the Kangaroo Tour from a side that only won two games that year.
Yeah.
But I just think Manly, I went there to win a comp, so I'm sitting on the fence, Maroon. You know I love South as well.
Yeah.
Les Davidson is a bit of an idol of yours, Spud. You know, you had the same haircut, the same moustache. Have we got any pictures anywhere?
I had four hairs. No, not one in the back pocket, but We certainly we looked alike. What blows me away too is if I ever go up to Dubbo, the amount of people that come up to me and go, "How are you, Les?" I go, "Mate, thanks for the compliment." I'm not Carol, unfortunately.
Great days. And what about you, Tooves? You've got a good life now, a good comfortable life living on the northern beaches and joining a bit of boating. Are you still keen to coach NRL?
Well, you know, I've applied for a few jobs, but unfortunately I haven't had a look in anywhere there. Mm. But, you know, like I'm still around. I love the rugby league itself. I love being involved.
Yeah.
It's been a big part of my life for the last, 40 years. Of course, I'd want to be involved at the highest level you can be. There's not too many jobs around at the moment, obviously, as well. But, I'm around and I'm very keen to be involved in some way or form, yes.
Yeah. So, mate, you what do you think was a more nervous time for you or more of a buzz for you, running out as a player for Manly in a grand final or coaching a Manly side in the grand final?
Well, there's massive amounts of difference. I mean, all football players want to play at the top level, okay? So you've got that. And a grand final is probably the ultimate sort of goal to win a competition as well. So running in the grand, sure, you can't beat that. Now, coach is a frustrating job, as many people have probably seen me in the box. It's emotional. It's draining and it's frustrating and it's makes you angry and makes you happy. It even brought a tear to my eye once. But so it's all those things involved. But you can't do anything about what's happening on the field, and that's the frustrating thing. So most coaches, I think, are frustrated players.
Mm.
That was me.
And
hey, Maroon, the only thing it really does is that there's only one bloke who actually still has got hair, and that's Desi. Otherwise, no one's got hair.
Yeah, and he's gone back for more, hasn't he, Desi?
Mate, he's got something going. Yeah. What about the way he puts his fingers through his hair? He's outstanding.
Boys, what about the camaraderie between blokes who have played football together at the highest level? It's one a great buzz about doing this job is that you bring them back together, you know, and those guys particularly that you won a premiership with Tooves, you know, it must be great to see him again or have those reunions and remember those times.
Yeah, what you mentioned is right. And we go back to what we said before about successful sides. Successful sides are sides that have got players that want to be with each other. Now, you don't have to like everyone that's in your side. Don't get me wrong, you don't have to like a lot of them, but you need to respect the people that are in your team.
Yeah.
And if you respect them, then you find that all of a sudden your close bonds, your friends, and that lasts beyond any rugby league playing field area. Mm. And you keep in contact, sure, but there's nothing better than you've lost contact with people for a while and you come back together and enjoy each other's company.
Yeah, it reminds me of that old story from Chris Anderson that I've heard many times where he thought the blokes weren't getting on, and so he said every one night a week we're all going to get together over a couple of beers or whatever and you're allowed to talk about anything but football. And they made the grand final that year and in fact beat Manly. That worked.
Yeah, it did work. But I remember an old school, we're talking about Ron Willie when I was at Penrith. I don't think the players do this enough. We're every Tuesday night. Back then we had three grades, back then the under-23s, reserve grade and first grade. We all had to go to a pub to have you weren't going to have a beer, you're going to have a soft drink or a water just to get together as a unit. No, I just think that's far lost in the game these days.
Yeah. Yeah, that's an interesting – it probably is, mate. You know, Tooves?
Yeah, well, I've asked people in the past. I did this when I was over in England coaching at Bradford. I said, righto, boys, what do you do away from football? And they sit there and stare at me and I go, what do you do to occupy yourself? And probably 80% of them say, sit around, watch music. Yeah. I mean, listen to music. They had no other passion in their life. Mm. And that's the problem, I think, sometimes with some of the players these days is that they're so enthralled and they have to be, mind you, to be professional football players. But what's their hobby? What's their passion away from football? You need something away from football. And that, as you mentioned before, the coach sits down and goes, okay, boys, what do you do away from here? You've got to get your mind away from football sometimes as well, because then when you come to training, you're passionate about it.
Yeah. But what about being over there to, say, going from the NRL and a side at grand final level, and a few years later you're over there and you're coaching in the UK Super League. I mean, you weren't in the top division.
No, second division.
But what was the obvious difference?
Well, again, I mean, it's just the intensity, I suppose, of all things that are involved, whether it be training, whether it be video sessions, whether it be the players themselves, their mental state of applying whatever they need to be the best they can be. Mm. And that's the difference, I think, between Australia and England at the moment.
Yeah.
In my opinion, it's just that application of intensity in everything they do.
Yeah. Spud, what about you, mate? You hear these – what annoys me these days as a rugby league supporter is when I hear players go – you know, they insist on what position they want to play. And – as a spectator and a lover of rugby league, I come from an era where I'd hear blokes like you say, I'll play where the coach tells me I've got to play.
Yeah, that's old school. They don't do that now. Hell, good buddy, Addo Carr reckons he's going there to play fullback.
Yeah. Mm.
Oh, so you don't think you can do that, Spud?
Nah, you've got to be a bit more skillful, mate. He can run. I don't know if I've seen him pass the ball yet. Man, I haven't seen him under a high ball, so... it's pretty important to be able to do that too, so when you're playing fullback.
Yeah.
Let's talk a little bit about the modern footballers, boys, because I know you both got busy schedules. I can't leave you here forever. And, of course, we talk about a bloke like Josh Addo-Carr or Latrell Mitchell. These are two classic examples of two players that want to go to different clubs with the opportunity in playing a certain position. Obviously, Latrell is injured right now, but do you see where I'm coming from here, Tooves? You know, when you were playing, you just played where you played.
Well, again, I don't know whether it's a product of the system or not, but yes, I would play wherever. I mean, I'd play in the front row. If the coach said play in the front row, I'd play in the front row. Well, I probably did. I ended up at hooker, but that's why my face is like this. But yeah. You laugh. Anyway, and I think they see it again as a job. So, look, my job is to go to work every day, okay? But I want to do this job. I don't want to play in the front row. I want to play in the wing. Yeah. I want to play fullback. So that's what I want. So you should put me there because that's what I want.
Yeah.
And you're paying me all this money, so that's my best position. That's what I'm going to do.
Yeah. Another thing that can piss me off too, Spud, is like what is a contract these days? You know, we always see players wanting to get out of contracts or wanting to, you know, swap or go to another club mid-contract, and the other club will say, well, you can do that if you get us somebody to come here.
Yeah, I agree, Maroon. But what is a bloody contract these days? Some of these guys, but also what about some of the money these blokes are on? Seriously, 700,000, 800,000, they don't save any bloody life. But that's good luck to them these days. Am I jealous? Probably, yes. Money we're on. But the thing is, I just think we always held our – when I signed the contract, I shook my hand. Shook the bozo hand. It was like, you know, in that movie, This Is Oak. But the signing of a contract these days, there should be better.
Did you get your hand back, Spud?
What? This Is Oak. Was that an adult feature, was it? I don't remember seeing that. Was that an X-rated movie, that one?
No. What's that bloody movie? No, was that – you remember the movie with I can't remember the guy. What's his name? Tom Cruise.
Mate, I haven't
the player agent.
I haven't got a theatre in my home like you. What's going on there? What's all that noise? Is there people in there working out?
Mate, I've just had a couple of clients rock up here. Right, I've got one we call a behemoth.
Yep.
A large mammal. Okay.
Yep.
That's Matt Asprey. Matt Asprey. Yeah. What's your company called? What is your East Coast Plumbing? You know him too.
Yeah. East Coast Plumbing.
And
very good.
We've got Mr. Ryan Sutton. Ryan Sutton, you bought a car off him, so thanks very much.
Yeah, tell him the bloke that he gave me to ring never rang me back. So, and tell him also it only took me 6 weeks to get the steering rack fixed, which I got yesterday. Anyway, last question, boys, before I go anywhere. If the 1996 Manly Premiers played the 2008 Manly Premiers, who would win? If the 1996 Manly Premiers played the 2008 Manly Premiers, who won, of course, 40-0 against Melbourne, who would win that game?
Are you allowed to punch?
You're allowed to do it.
Oh, please. The old team would smash them.
Yeah? Who was that forward pack that year? Cement, was he?
Cement. Daniel Gardner, Nick Kosev, Beaver.
Yeah.
Best back three in the game.
They were good.
Spud, what do you think? If the 96 Manly side played the 2008 Manly side, who would win?
I just think old school, we'd bash them. Yeah. Really bash them.
Mm. All right, mate. Well, look, thank you so much for your time. Spud's gym now at its new location at 72 Crown Street. You go in there, it's like...
No, it's not there.
Well, why is it 72 Crown Street on the wall there?
No, because I just put up the memorabilia. That's right. Old school. Now it's 13 Foley Street, a street back from Oxford Street.
Okay.
Oh, that's your gaze, bud.
Yeah, but you get in there, it's like happy hour on Fairstar, the fun ship. Mate, you got.
I had a bad experience here, late in the Maroon. What is this? I walked past, I was in this place that had Sydney sauna. I went, oh, how good is this? I'm a place I can get a, go and get a sauna. Oh, mate, I went upstairs. I seen the board. Tight ass Tuesday, nudie Thursday.
Tooves, you've got to go and do a bit of accounting now.
Oh, yeah. Thanks very much.
Yeah, or Baz and GST. Spud, we'll catch up with you at our next sports lunch.
Go on, you boys. Look and forward to it.
Tooves, before, can you take us out with, it's got to be an investigation.
There's got to be an investigation, Spud. I'm telling you.
See you next time on the Legends of League podcast.
See you, mate.
Hey, thanks for being with us for another week of the Legends of League podcast. We thank our brand partner, Two Four Pines Brewing Company. You can give them a follow and help us all out at Four Pines Beer, or check out the website, fourpinesbeer.com. That's four, fourpinesbeer.com. Be sure to subscribe to the Legends of League podcast so you never miss an episode. And, of course, you can show your support by rating us, leaving us a review, whatever you like to do. See all the best bits and the big announcements, too, on social media at Legends of League AUS. That's Legends of League AUS. It's Maroon here. We'll see you next time on the Legends of League podcast.